show in Bristol this week, and I just have to say, I feel at home, because I'm looking around the room, I'm seeing my peer group, and my peer group now, in 2020, is world people. We're all old, it's not like it's a bad thing. We're getting old. I'm at the back, I'm at the back, and the DJ playing the Drifters. The Drifters. And all of you know the songs. You know how old that music is. Lord, in fact, you lot, before I go much further, we're so old, you know what we should do? We should give ourselves a round of applause just for being still alive. I have to say that because, let me tell you how we're old. Everyone in this room, bar maybe three people, remember outside toilets and paraffin. That's right, we come before Keller Gas, we're old. You know what I mean? This DJ, this is my nice new modern equipment, he have him laptop and speaker. He might play tunes so long when he first started, because I play Bangor on my phone, right? You know the start of the wine up thing? Him survived, round of applause for the man who survived that long. He come from the gramophone era to the laptop era. We all, let me just tell you something before I go much further, right? We as comedians, most comedians, we don't like the job. It's a great job, but we're jealous of singers. Because you lot, particularly you women, you give singers too much respect compared to comedians. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's a great talent singing, we know that. But you know what? The ugly singer get more respect than the best looking comedian. And you like, oh, so you know what's coming. Let me give you some examples. These are some talented artists. But I'm saying, sometimes I'm seeing women screaming at man them singing, and I can't understand it. Like DJ earlier on played a Barry White tune. Barry White was very talented, could write, produce everything. But Barry White was not pretty. A woman was a lose their mind because of them being boys. When I started doing stand-up comedy, the most popular reggae artist at the time was Shabba Ranks. Talented MC, very talented MC, but again, not pretty. But yeah, the man up on TV and on stage, a woman that screamed for Shabba. Shabba, take me, Shabba! I'm thinking, am I seeing right? Woman that screamed for Shabba, like Shabba sexy. At moments like this, it takes me back nostalgically. I think about my time at school, because in my class at school, there was somebody who used to remind me of Shabba. I used to go out with her. Times was hard, all right? Don't judge me. Do not judge me, Bristol. Times was hard. You have to get love where you can't get love, you understand? And exactly, this is actually, it's a lovely organization. I love the event. Nice to see all the love in the room. Nice, but you're going to work nice, but it's on the worst weekend of the year. Valentine's weekend is the worst weekend of the year. Let me tell you something. It's always right to celebrate stuff, but Christmas is great because everybody celebrates together, family and friends, love is in the room. Birthday, you celebrate one person. Valentine is different because Valentine's about two people. And you're supposed to have love and all that. And Valentine is a weekend when people turn to their partner and realize they don't like them. You just forget all the other weekends. The calendar says you must be loving her. I can't stand him. And then, what are you all to have sex? And then, I can't stand the other one. Any excuse not to do it? I'll be coming back to that thing later on, by the way. This is weird, though, you know, because, like I say, I've been on many TV programs, lots of you since some of them. I've been around on stage for many years. But it don't matter what I do, I know I will never talk Teletubbies as a show, because that's in 121 countries, unexpectedly. It's a worldwide phenomenon. If I come outside tonight and get hit by a bus, it will make the newspapers and the headline will be that Deep Sea dies. So, you know what I mean? And I don't care, it's nice to get recognition, a worldwide successful show. But let me tell you something, Bristol, as you can imagine. As the son of Jamaican parents born in the UK, I wanted to make a name for myself, but as in comedy, but Teletubbies was not what I had in mind. You understand? I mean, I'm glad for the song, but it's not quite what I had in mind. When the BBC contacted me, they were like, we've got a show for you. I was like, yeah, about time too. Yeah, about time too. I'm the way up on the kicked up life. What have you got for me? And they said, it's children's TV. I'm like, nah, we're not the children. You might be a bad boy, I'm telling you. Children's TV, you know, and they're like, it's preschool children. I was like, nah, man, we don't have no interest in preschool children, unless they've been in my family. And they were like, You'll be the first suit. And I'm like, stop writing about first suit. You're a bad boy. Those days, I used to play sound system as well. So the idea of put on first suit. And then they explained to me that it was a 3-year TV contract. Yeah, things changed at that moment in time. That's right. 3 years. Some TV contract is 1 day, you do 2 lines and you're gone. Them say it's a 3-year contract. Like, 3 years. I went from, me not put on no suit, me a bad boy, to 3 years. That's right, sign up fast. And I said, sign up fast. I didn't know what I was coming to now. I'm glad for the booking and so on. They said it's a cricket club. And once again, we love our sports, we don't. But I didn't realize that cricket that could still play cricket and get so old. This must be the oldest cricket team in the world. I want to know if your opponents are just as old as you are. Because that must be the fast bowler at the current age. It probably bowled the ball at 1 mile an hour. But because the opponent is also just as old, the batsman, that look fast, the batsman. We take sports serious, you know. I don't know where you're from, people, you're different islands. But I have to take you back to my favorite sporting moment, which was when Jamaica qualified for the World Cup in football. Yeah? Because Jamaica's not a football power, we know that. Jamaica's very influential. But in football, but take you back, it might be on YouTube. Jamaica needed 1 point, a draw from their last match. Let me get it right. I think they were playing Mexico. Mexico, correct? Thank you. Okay? They needed a draw, just 1 point to get through, and that's it now, they got it. But that's not what I'm talking about. There you go. You know, I'll tell you. What happened was one of the Jamaican players fouled one of the Mexican players, and yes, it was a foul. However, the Mexican lad got up and tugged the Jamaican guy in the mouth. I said, this is the Sheikah head, that's right, that's a bad move. Because a fight starts, and remember, these normal professional footballers, it don't go too far. You know what I mean? Manchester United fighting Liverpool, a few pushes and referees stop it. However, the Mexican players hadn't got the full information. They didn't receive the memo. They thought they were fighting fellow professional footballers. There is no such thing as a professional football league in Jamaica, all right? We've got talented players, but the team is consisting of Kingston ghetto youth. We don't punch one of these guys in the mouth with people watching on telly. Can't even have a reputation for defend. So the fight started, and like I said, it was like a normal bit of scuffling between two professional teams. And then that moment, back on YouTube, that moment happened when the Jamaican players started like, hold on. Fist fighting went out of fashion in Jamaica in about 1962. Jamaican players ran off the field. And just for a second, the Mexican team thought they'd won the fight. Yeah, what's that all going on? Oh no. The Jamaican lads come back on the field, okay, with brick, bottle, stone. You remember that? I was so embarrassed. Man, pick up a piece of the seat in my sit down. They didn't find the original version of coronavirus and a triple. Damn. I was like, wow, don't take sports too seriously, people. You know, life too short to take sports too seriously. I mean, I have to say, like I said, I'm proud of my heritage. I hope everybody, I don't care what you are, black, white, anything, Asian, be proud of your heritage, okay? My heritage is Jamaican, but I'm actually born here. I'm born in this country, unlike Boris Johnson. You realize that the Prime Minister of this country, the current Prime Minister, is actually born in New York, which means he is an immigrant coming over here and taking our jobs. And I used to deport the immigrants, we need to deport him ass. Let's start the movement next week outside Parliament. Immigrant with a criminal record, get on the plane back to New York. Yeah. You have to see these things for what they are, people. You really have to see these things for what they are. And there's so much to discuss. There's so much I have to discuss. Let me tell you a few things, okay? You have to take your culture wherever you are. That's my thing, you know. We throw away your culture. It's not because you're not harming nobody. Life is too short. I mean, you know what? Doing this job, I'm years behind the curve. I only just saw the movie Titanic weeks ago. Because what happens, you do lots of shows and you end up in hotels after a show late at night and you're full of Red Bulls, so of course you'll see what's on the TV. I saw Titanic and you know what? Years after everybody else, I thought, now I see why this movie was so popular back in the day. It was the number one box office movie before the same director, James Cameron, later beat it with Avatar. And I thought, I saw why, because we had everything. Special effects, gorgeous leads you cared about, tragedy, bitter, everything except some black people on the ship. Not one black character. And because it's Valentine's, I want to take it home a little bit, people. Think about love. You know, because you know, if there's any black people on the ship, any black on the ship, that would be in a different situation. That tragedy demonstrated to me Britain at its best, because the ship is sinking. They've already told us, because it was supposed to be unsinkable, there were not enough lifeboats. Leonardo DiCaprio's character knew there were not enough lifeboats and still there. That's because it wasn't Jamaica. I'm going to get to the chase now, people. Because you know the situation, the ship is sinking. Tragedy. What was actually genuinely wonderful about British people? They said, abandon ship, women and children first. First, that's right, women and children first. That's a wonderful sentiment. When there's danger all around you and so on, that's really selfless of me. Let's save the ladies, let's save the children. But like as I said to you before, there's no Jamaicans on the ship. Us Jamaican men love all women and our children just as much as any other person. We love them. We love them. But right now the ship is sinking. These are different times. Some of the people say, children first! Let me tell you something for free. Every 5 year old who wants to get to one of those few lifeboats before me is going to have to fight me. The ship is sinking. I'll tell you more, they could say the same thing when people say, women first, what about your girlfriend? I just told you the ship is sinking. Girlfriend? What girlfriend? We're done! Right now I don't need a girlfriend, I need a lifeboat. You understand? If I get a lifeboat, I can get another girlfriend. You see the Jamaican logic right there? And then I couldn't believe what I'm seeing, because at one point, towards the end, the gorgeous leads, gorgeous Kate Winslet, gorgeous, handsome Leonardo DiCaprio, them in the Atlantic freezing cold. Again, trying to keep each other's morale up. I love you. I love you too. Don't go blue, you don't go blue, because that's the next film, that's Avatar. Oh, yeah. DiCaprio reached out and got a piece of driftwood. Okay? And they climbed on the driftwood, but their combined weight was too heavy for the piece of wood. What did DiCaprio do? He got off the piece of wood. Now he's fine! Gets off him one piece of wood back into the freezing water. Then the question is obvious at this point in the proceedings, ladies. Which Jamaican man would have done that? Which Jamaican man would have get off a piece of wood back into the water to freeze to death? Don't get me wrong, a lovely woman, but right now, I feel you would. Fill me wood! You have to come off, fill me wood! If I ain't even wood! You're gonna push cables off the piece of wood back into the water and say, give me your shoes! I need paddles, we're going to help. Understand, this is just a little inkling into how our world works. You know what I mean? I have to say that, because some of the time I just wonder about us people. Because today's children don't know about discipline. We were the first telepathic people. And it doesn't matter about your gender, as a young black child, it doesn't matter about your island, it could be Bajan, Trinidadian, it don't matter, you know, you knew that your mother could talk to you in her face. You know what I mean? You know that your mother could talk to you in her face, you go to somebody's yard, and you say, oh, you want something to eat? And you want to look at your mother, you can see your mother, she doesn't even set up, she doesn't look upon you like, there's a certain black pride, as if when you go to your friend's house, if you take food, it's like you don't have no food at your own. That's some weird pride, you know what I mean? I have to say, let me tell you something about another stereotype about black men in particular. They always think we're good at sports and we can fight and all that. So that's just a stereotype. Some of us are good, some of us not so good. It's just a stereotype. Let me tell you something though. The last time I nearly had a fight, and this is true, I was in Paris, okay? And I was in my Teletubby suit. I have to explain this, outer street, what was going on. First of all, it was 10 years of Teletubbies. Like I said, it's all over the world. So they said, you're going to go to Paris, take some pictures outside the Eiffel Tower, that's so good. And in a Teletubby suit, there is no peripheral vision. You look through the mouth. So it's like being in a postbox. So there's an earpiece and the director saying, a bit left, cool, a bit right, everything on the left, and so on. And then what happened? Some youth walking boss, 14, the clever and impressing brethren, them by slapping a Teletubby. He slapped the wrong one. He slapped the wrong one, because let me explain to you. He was just sticking his head on his phone, and it never hurt because I was well padding, but that's not the point. I come from Handsworth in Birmingham. You don't put your hand on the clothes, even when you're for a suit, because something has to go on then, you understand it? So as he walked past, and after I won't go into much detail, and he slapped the tiny top of his suit, and I slap him back. Same time, instinct. And now, let me explain something. To move the tiny top of his mouth, to make the face move, we used to do that. So we used to, anything we said, we said. And to move the eyes, left hand, blink every few seconds, make it look animated, part of one success. So not only did I slap him, and I won't spear him, but I said, oh, what do you think you're doing? So of course, like I said, anything he said, it's ready to be said. So when I said that, BWIPCC said, what do you think you're doing? I'm not making this stuff up, okay? The director is losing his mind on the ear. He's like, I'm something messed him up. Do that again. Let me explain to you. I tell you to be suit. I'm like 7 foot tall. Okay? This suit, like all youths across the world, dressing, you know, usual clothes, hip hop clothes, trainers, etc. Tartan was interested in friending. Right now, I'm friending my back off. Because I'm the lips is step forward and lips is 7 foot. And it's funny because I'm thinking, these supposed to be boys, they back tough as this one. You versus the Teletubby. And I'm pushing this youth and do that again. Remember, I'm in Paris. I don't know if you understand. Okay? But in face, no fear. You know, in face, right now, in face, no fear. And in virtual, they're backing off. And the director's screaming down the earpiece, leave it. And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, I'm supposed to leave it. But part of my brain thinks, this could be the ultimate YouTube moment. Playing like a French wannabe gangster, getting bossed up in the street by BWIPCC. You know? He would never fight again. I'm just thinking, here we are now, in 2020. Boy, have things changed. The curriculum is so nice, and everything is cool. I feel wonderful because it was our entertainment. Like I said, some of you saw the show last week. I was trying to make him tell him what the school is, because back in the day, we used to have Tarzan. You know Tarzan? And that was like, what type of man is this? This brother, the only non-African in Africa, which is him one can speak to the animals. Him one of a house up in the... I used to watch the type of thing. Oh, look, I feel much worse than that. Let me tell you something. Please, wherever you are, live loving. With everybody, we should live loving. But don't bow down to anybody, because I can't believe how some people get embarrassed by what's going on with the royal family right now. And as I said, Prince Andrew, the Grand Duke of York. People say, people acting as if the royal family was actually nice. It was never nice. That's a very strange family from there. That you don't even have to look upon Andrew. I'll leave the Lord to take its course on that one. But look upon Andrew, brother Charles. He was a man who was married to Princess Diana. At this point, you're supposed to hear harps, because the country, harps and flowers, the country's done, and then Princess Diana, this man had Princess Diana. Prince Andrew's brother Charles looks at Princess Diana and thinks, "Ew, yuck, you don't want that." And look over at Camilla. I'll say it again, over here, son, Princess Diana. Over here, son, Camilla. And he's, I want that. That is strange genes. These are the genes Prince Andrew have. Let me tell you something. Those are because I've already established that with wood. Yeah, with wood. So, you remember, okay, Andrew's granny, the Queen Mother. Think back, because those used to say, oh, the Queen Mom is a favorite grandmother. No, not mine. The favorite grandmother was my own grandmother. No disrespect, but because think about it. This is what I never understood. Okay? The Queen Mother had all this money from us. Now think back carefully, old people. She also had what I remember to be the most filthiest teeth I ever saw. Remember that? We used to watch it. And there was, oh, it's lovely. And we look at Jamaica sugar. What's up to our teeth? Oh, that's a nasty. And we'd be like, Mommy, what? And your mother slap you, don't say that. And I used to think to myself, that's weird. She should have a toothbrush. Somebody should say something. Somebody should say something, because she only had to sip water to turn that into soup. That is. And I'm talking Campbell's soup, because what I have to say about our soup, which I enjoyed the soup today, by the way. The chef did a good job, loved the food, loved the service. Everything worked nicely. But when you talk to your friends at school, they never understood when you say you're going home for soup for dinner, and you might not be able to play football later on. Because Jamaican soup is not Campbell's soup. You understand that? So you may say, are you going to play football in the street? Nah, it's soup today. I don't think I'll be able to move. And your friends were thinking, what's he talking about? Just having soup. Then thinking your mum would open a little tin, pour it out, and what? No, to those who might not be, you know, familiar with West Indian soup, you need a knife and fork to eat it. Forget the spoon. Dumpling, yam, banana, dashi, bits of meat, everything. Think like that, and by the time you're done, it is over. I mean, we come from a wonderful culture. culture. Let's enjoy ourselves, though. Time short. I'm not wearing Boris. And the thing is, we was laughing in America. Remember a while ago, we said, all Americans got themselves a blonde racist as a leader. And then we go and get yourself a blonde racist as well. You see how things change? And people call Boris so much posh, everybody vote for him and so on. I'm gonna say a few things to people. You know, we're old. We should enjoy being old because you know what? It's Valentine weekend and war. A couple of things I have to say. They asked the selection of British men from all backgrounds. Black, Asian, white, everything. They said, given a choice of a woman whose size, this was what we would bring here, size 10 or 16. And I thought, 10 is not particularly small, 16 is not large, it's just normal, you know, scale of woman's size. But they said that 70% of British men prefer a size 16. I was like, yes. See, that is not just a black thing. Well, meat on the bones, that's a normal size. And then they said that in the UK, you could Google this because it's not a type of show. They have sex in the UK less than the French or the Italians, but when they do, Britain apparently are the spanking champions of Europe. It's a cultural thing. But let me explain something to you. Whatever you do is up to you, for your business, but I'm interested. But because Britain don't tend to talk about that sort of thing, we are a nation of secret spankers. And I thought it's getting interesting. I think, you know, that's an interesting concept. Them do that, but they don't talk about it because your business, you keep it private. But then, to illustrate the point, they're saying we were living in bootylicious Britain. Okay, I understand the concept. And then they said that Kylie Minogue had a bootylicious butt. No disrespect. Kylie has a pert butt, okay? A bootylicious butt, if somebody sits in this chair right here with a bootylicious butt, I would not be able to see the cheer card, the bottom just spread out across the chair. Just look like the woman just a squat down, that's right. He's a beautiful African thing, a nice bootylicious butt. So it said, I had to thought to myself, hold on, if that's your sort of thing, the spanking thing, to spank up my butt properly with proper satisfaction, you'd have to take a run up. That's right, from St. Paul's, build up some speed, you understand? And I thought, if you was to spank a proper bootylicious butt properly, it would spank you right back. That's the soup for you, you understand? So I'm thinking to myself before I go, you couldn't spank Kylie on the book. That should fly through the window. That wouldn't be fortunate. That's domestic violence. You understand? It's all of a context. And I'm gonna, this is the point I want to leave you, because it's Valentine weekend. People, I'm old, you're old, I'm glad we're still here. Okay? I'm glad we're still here, but every relationship only has three stages. Okay? I don't care what your background, they only have three stages. The first stage is the meeting. She is looking for a relationship. Very, 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 very reasonable and understandable. Back in the day, us guys, we were looking for sex. You know, we're young, we had the energy, was like second stage. She, because this time you've been together a while, you like each other, you're getting all right, decided you're not feeding each other too much. She is looking for commitment. We. The third and final stage of most heterosexual relationships. With what I know, it's Valentine, we're coming to a cricket show. We are looking for the remote control and a good night's sleep. Priorities change. Priorities change. Meanwhile, she is looking for sex, and I'm not going to leave you. Thank you very much for listening.